Bunsen Labs, what kind of distro name is that? I actually happen to like it. According to the forums, it has no real meaning. It's like the spiritual successor to the venerable Crunchbang Linux back from when the founder stepped down and discontinued it because he felt like it didn't serve any purpose anymore. Which is a little weird to me because I think Bunsen Labs, and by extension Crunchbang Linux, are one of the most fascinating distros I've seen in a long time. So Bunsen Labs is based on Debian and it uses the delightfully bizarre Debian installer. It's pretty old school, but it gets the job done. You can do pretty much the same thing here as you can do in like Ubiquiti or Calamares. A weird thing that it does is it shows the keys and passwords in the clear. So like my Wi-Fi key is in the clear, and there's an option to show root and user passwords in the clear. A little odd. It failed the first time I actually tried to install, but it let me go back to like this weird main menu thing, and I clicked one of the options that I hadn't seen during the normal install workflow, and it took me back to the install portion, which worked this time, so I don't know. Now the welcome app is where things start to get interesting. This is it. After login for the first time, this is the welcome app. It's a terminal. It seems to be like a script or a set of scripts that accept user input and handle basic things like updates, adding additional repos, and installing various bits of software, like Java and the LAMP stack. Like, pretty 2000s-era choices, but whatever. After the updates and everything, we can see a fresh and updated Bunsen Labs install weighs about 3.5 gigabytes. And the desktop here is using about 292 megabytes of memory. Hot damn. And while we're here, let's take a look at NeoFetch, because it's a terminal. So we see the Bunsen Labs logo, which is pretty cool, honestly. It's based on Debian Stale, so it's got kernel version 4.9.0 with 1,129 packages and an old version of Bash 4.4. The desktop here is XFCE OpenBox. It's like a Frankenstein thing, with custom icons and themes. So this Frankenstein desktop is what makes Bunsen Labs special. The Conky implementation on the right is probably the best I've ever seen. It shows all of the vital system information without cramming it full of a bunch of stupid logos and frivolous crap. And because the desktop is maybe a little weird for newcomers, there's a list of shortcuts right here. So you can just look at them if you get confused or whatever. It's awesome, I love it. And going to the top of the screen, we've got a power button, clock, the regular widgets, including XFCE's power manager, which is Spartan, but it does the job. The file manager is Thunar. The text editor is Genie, which is actually a lightweight IDE. An odd choice. Now, being the polar opposite from Windows and more user-friendly Linux distros, almost everything that you want to customize has to be done through config files, save for a few things like desktop themes and whatnot. Now, whether this is good or bad is really up to you. But it's cool that links to the pertinent files are listed here, so you don't have to just like magically know exactly where they are to edit them. And each one of these config files has just a ton of comments in them explaining which each option does. That's awesome. The bar at the top in the middle is called Tint, and it's like a workspace switcher thing. And there's no real start menu or launcher thingy either. Instead, it's like a menu that's attached to the mouse cursor. But if you want to run a specific program, there's no search or anything like that. You have to use a run dialog. So hopefully you know what command you're looking for. This whole workflow might feel a little barbaric from today's desktop standards, but once you get used to it, it actually flows pretty well. There are a couple themes for the desktop, but they're all practically the same. They're just color palette swaps. It does come with this thing called Blobs, which is like a desktop presets manager. XFCE has the same sort of thing, and it's basically like canned desktop presets that you can apply so it'd bring the panel from the top to the bottom and maybe reorganize it or something, which is a nice touch. And the desktop backgrounds, I spent way too much time here. I'll just say that the wallpapers were outstanding. The look and feel of the desktop in general, like Bunsen Labs, whoever's in charge of the style, oh, you did a phenomenal job. In the way of default apps, there were even more surprises. You got the standard defaults like editors, media players, media viewers, and things like that, but there's also shortcuts to install other applications, like they embed themselves in the lists as if they were, you know, already installed, but when you click them, it pops up a terminal installer. This is incredibly seamless and smooth, and they're basically like curated apps, and it's executed so well. And in the application menu, there's a dedicated section for help resources like Bunsen Labs forums and the Arch Wiki. Obviously, this isn't based on Arch, but the Arch Wiki transcends Linux distributions, and it's just an excellent all-around reference for anything Linux. So based on how minimal Bunsen Labs is, I was not expecting it to have printer support out of the box, but it did. I had to add it manually, but it detected and installed my printer just fine. This is better than some mainstream Linux distributions. I didn't see any support for Bluetooth, but you could presumably install it, and my Samba shares on the network connected without much of an issue. It did do this weird thing with the Streamtop where it connected, but it didn't show me any files, and then it disconnected me, and then reconnected me, and then the files were there, so I don't know what that was about. There didn't seem to be any support for EXFAT, but again, that's probably something you can install from the repos. It did support all of the archive formats, including the RAR file, and it played back all of the media files, like audio and video, just fine without a single issue. No stuttering, no nothing. Outstanding. There's no Flatpak or Snap support, and the Etcher app did that Debian thing where it complained about mounting the temporary file system for the app image. The Pling Store worked just fine though. You can install apps from the repos from the command line with apt, or you can use the Synaptic Package Manager. Unfortunately, this is where I started running into some issues with Bunsen Labs. For starters, only 64-bit is supported out of the box, and nothing tells you that. I had to go to the forums to find out why I couldn't find Steam in the repo. Adding 32-bit support seems like something that should be included in the welcome app, like it should at least ask you, but besides the additional weight and complexity, is there a reason why they decided not to support i386? Anyway, it was here that I realized I was using the open source NVIDIA drivers, which is honestly quite impressive because none of the videos had playback issues at all, so. On Debian, you can install the NVIDIA drivers from a meta package in the repo, but on Debian Stable, it's not good. Bunsen Labs was showing NVIDIA version 390, which is really old, and surprise, it didn't work at all. First, the meta package doesn't install the X.org driver, but it happily installs the open source driver. So if you were to install the meta package like I did and reboot, it just drops you to a TTY. Fun. So then I installed the X.org drivers and rebooted, but something else was screwed up because it completely hosed up LightDM. Like, bad. I uninstalled the NVIDIA driver completely, but it didn't seem to reinstall the open source driver, and the whole thing was hosed up, and I just said screw it and reinstalled. Once that ordeal was over, I tried playing some games with the open source driver, and it was, well, you tell me. This is a real simple Unity game called Golf with Your Friends, and what do you think? Remember, this GPU is an NVIDIA 750 Ti. It's pretty old, but it's also a pretty powerful card. Now let's try another one. It's called Redi, and it's somewhat similar to, like, Hotline Miami, but without the aesthetic and quicker gameplay, I think. But to me, this was anything but fast or quick. I mean, at least it didn't glitch out or have texture problems, right? There were a couple other games I wanted to try out, like Void Bastards here, but the open source drivers were like, nope, you aren't playing this. So, I guess that's the end of the gaming segment, right? Well, I've got a surprise for you. I recently acquired an AMD R370, which is, again, an older card, but according to the specs, it's even better than my NVIDIA 750 Ti. At least on Windows, anyways. Let's see how it does on Linux. Now, I couldn't get Mango HUD to work at all. It supposedly installed, but each time I tried to launch it, the game just, like, crashed, so I don't know. This is Mesa version 13.0.6, so not the latest version, but at least it's running smooth, right? Redi seemed to work perfectly, though. Golf with Your Friends and Redi are both Unity games, but Redi is running perfect. It's a fun game, too. You should try it out. Next, I wanted to give XCOM 2 a spin, and starting with the title screen, things just felt a little off. And in the loading screen before mission, it felt a little bit off too here, but I couldn't place exactly what it was. And then we dropped into the actual map, and I realized I only had 4 guys to control. That's because I forgot to launch it with the Long War 2 mod installed, so that's what's missing here. But it's running really smooth, right? This has got to be around 60 frames a second. And last up is Deus Ex Mankind Divided. I featured this game in a few episodes now, including the Windows versus Linux comparison. I used the 750 Ti in those episodes, so NVIDIA, just kind of an older card. And I will let you guys tell me what you think of Deus Ex here. So right away, let's talk about Debian Stable. Obviously, I was being cheeky in the gaming performance section, but being based on Debian Stable gets you grossly outdated packages. Luckily with Debian, though, it's easy to just opt into the next series of repos, whether they're unstable, testing, or whatever, so you can do that. But for distro delves, we look at distros out of the box. So this is Bunsen Labs with all of the defaults and everything. Just a run-of-the-mill daily driver, I think it's fine. For a netbook or a low-end PC like a laptop or something like that, Bunsen Labs is without question a good choice. But if you have newer hardware, NVIDIA graphics, or plan to do really any 3D gaming, stock Bunsen Labs is probably not a good choice. Again, you could install it and then add your own repos and customize it and make your own little hot rod, but out of the box, Overall though, I am super impressed with Bunsen Labs. When I first started tinkering with it, my first thought was like, this is what non-users think Linux desktops are like. And I mean, that's not meant to be a dig at anyone or anything. I think this is a great workflow for some. But this isn't a standard Linux desktop. It's actually quite unique. And honestly, the workflow translates pretty well into the modern era of desktop computing. If you've never heard of it though, don't worry. Bunsen Labs has a pretty healthy community of users and it's not going anywhere anytime soon. It's not one of those distros. The core group of maintainers are from Crunchbang Linux, so they're competent folks. And if this desktop interests you, you should give Bunsen Labs a try. Customize it, add some repos, and make it your own. Because that's what Linux on the desktop is all about. Making your desktop, your desktop. Your own personal oasis.